want you to hit me as hard as you can.
In today's endless barrage of comic book movies, with their idealistic heroes saving the world from bland supervillains, 2015's Fantastic Four attempted to be something entirely different. By ditching the superhero theatrics, it focused on hard sci-fi and the horrors of gaining superpowers. For a comic known for its colorful and fun super family, it was a bold move. Unfortunately, Fantastic Four was a joyless mess that squandered any of its unique ideas with lifeless performances, underdeveloped characters, and a rushed ending. So let's take another look at everything that went wrong and try to piece together the full story of what the f*** happened to this movie. In the late 1980s, German movie producer Bernd Eichinger purchased the film rights to the Fantastic Four from the comic creator himself, Stan Lee. Under this deal, Eichinger needed to make a film by the end of 1992, or the rights would revert back to Marvel. However, due to budget concerns, no production company would back him. In a desperate move, Eichinger hired B-movie master Roger Corman to make the adaptation for a meager $1 million. Corman pulled it off, and soon trailers and promotional material went out to the public with a January 1994 release date.
It's clobbering time!
But unbeknownst to the cast and crew, the film was never intended to be released and was only made so Eichinger could keep the rights. Marvel Entertainment's head executive, A.B. Arad, then purchased the film and destroyed every known print,
though obviously not successful,
fearing the movie would damage the brand. Nearly a decade later, the enormous success of Bryan Singer's X-Men and Sam Raimi's Spider-Man kickstarted the industry's comic book gold rush, with every studio buying up any rights they could. For Eichinger, the gamble of producing, then burying, a superhero film had finally paid off. He soon began working with 20th Century Fox to develop a big-budget version of the Fantastic Four. Tim Rothman, the head of 20th Century Fox at the time, was determined to have another franchise to milk alongside their lucrative X-Men films. But to keep costs low, Fox hired a director with only low-budget comedies under his belt and cast lesser-billed stars. Released in 2005, Tim Story's Fantastic Four was a silly, feature-length sitcom with questionable acting and a total lack of creativity.
Let's not fight.
No, let's.
While the film garnered pretty terrible reviews from both critics and moviegoers, it was financially a big hit. So, of course, Fox immediately greenlit a sequel. 2007's Fantastic Four, Rise of the Silver Surfer, kept the same cast and crew, but learned nothing from the mistakes of the previous film. The critical reception was hardly an improvement. Still childish, still forgettable. And this time, audiences didn't make up for the higher cost. Any plans for a third outing were put on ice.
All that you know is at an end.
In 2009, Fox jumped on the reboot bandwagon and announced a remake of the Fantastic Four property. Once again, attempts to get production rolling were on and off. Producers came and went, and writers struggled to tackle how to avoid past errors. In the meantime, Fox released the low-budget sci-fi film Chronicle, about three teens who gained superpowers. The gritty found footage take on superhero origins was well received and made a huge profit on its $15 million budget in 2012. It was the first feature for writer Max Landis and director Josh Trank. Clearly impressed and hoping to make Trank an in-house director, Fox president of production, Emma Watts, asked him about Fantastic Four. After declaring his love for the comics, he quickly pitched her a movie where we'd make the science modern, and the accident where they get their powers would play out as a horror scene. A few months later, Watts hired the 28-year-old to take on the reboot. The first draft was written by newcomer Jeremy Slater, and a rough outline can be seen in the final film. Reed Richards and Ben Grimm being childhood friends, building a teleporter as kids, Reed getting a scholarship to work at the Baxter Building with Victor Von Doom, where they build a quantum gate to reach the negative zone, Ben becoming a tool for the military, and the focus on body horror. However, his version was a big superhero spectacle that wore its comic book origins on its sleeves, with Victor being a spy for his home country of Latveria, a huge set piece set in New York where the Thing is swallowed by a giant moloid, and Galactus being the source of their powers. But executives weren't looking to copy what Marvel Studios was doing with the MCU, and wanted a more grounded approach, much like Trank's Chronicle, and of course Christopher Nolan's Dark Knight trilogy. In 2013, X-Men alum Matthew Vaughn and Simon Kinberg were brought on as producers, with Kinberg set to rewrite Slater's script with input from Josh Trank. Once Kinberg finished in January of 2014 and casting began, Trank focused on getting a promising younger cast, and he assembled a dream team of upcoming actors with proven dramatic chops. Production officially started in May of 2014 in Louisiana. By this time, Trank was such a hot commodity, he was also hired to helm the second Star Wars spinoff that following month. From its announcement all the way through to its release, Fantastic Four was plagued with endless hate from the online community. A lot of it was petty. Jamie Bell's too short, Miles Teller too young. But by far the worst was after Michael B. Jordan was cast as the always white Johnny Storm, and the racist trolls came out in droves, proving again how hateful and toxic online fandom has become. And to be fair to some of the real criticisms, every announcement did seem like the filmmakers completely misunderstood the source material. Right off the bat, Trank and Kinberg were selling a dark, realistic movie with little humor and comparisons to a David Cronenberg body horror film, a far cry from the vibrant adventures on the page. Kate Mara was told by Trank not to read the comics because the film wasn't based on any of them. Toby Kebbell came out and said that he wasn't playing Victor Von Doom, the tyrant from Latveria. Instead, he was Victor Domyshev, an antisocial programmer who goes by Doom on blogging sites. It all sounded a bit misguided and confusing. It didn't help that production was kept insanely secret, with not even a set photo or a teaser poster. The very first images of the film were leaked photos of a bust of the Thing and a questionable design for Dr. Doom. It wasn't until January of 2015 that news hit hard and fast. Fox finally revealed the first official look of Fantastic Four with a very somber, interstellar-like teaser trailer.
Human beings have an immeasurable desire to discover.
We've always defined ourselves by the ability to overcome the impossible.
And for a moment, it showed promise for every audacious choice we had heard so far. That is, if it weren't for the news barely a week earlier that Fox was ordering massive reshoots. Insiders were calling the film a total mess. It seemed that any story related to the film was unavoidably a cause for concern, and the rest of 2015 was nothing but bad news. Rumors swirled of a film with an unfinished script, a budget cut days before principal photography, vandalized sets, chaotic working conditions, a director too high to speak, and Fox wanting to hit the reset button before the rights returned to Marvel. Trank and 20th Century Fox had to either deny or spin each story, putting out fires left and right. The strangest rumor that wouldn't die was about Trank's four dogs destroying a New Orleans home. Fox was renting the house for Trank during production, and when the owner confronted him about the destruction, he smashed up the house even more, costing Fox nearly $100,000 in damages. Later in April, Fox strangely chose to release the second full trailer for Fantastic Four on a Sunday morning. A weird day to debut any trailer, but this happened to be the exact time Trank was missing from Disney's Star Wars celebration, where he was scheduled to reveal his rumored Boba Fett spinoff. His reasoning was illness, but 2 weeks later, Disney announced that Trank was leaving the project. Turns out that Lucasfilm president Kathleen Kennedy investigated the reported issues and discovered a set in utter disarray. Trank was characterized as erratic and isolated. Allegedly, producers Simon Kinberg and Hutch Parker were the ones barely keeping production under control, holding Trank on a short leash. Kennedy decided to part ways with Trank, forcing him to quit. And the hits just kept coming. By late May, less than 3 months before release, reshoots were still going due to Miles Teller's scheduling conflicts. And rumoredly, they were being shadow-directed by producer Matthew Vaughn, who had just finished Kingsman. Trank replied to all of these reports stating, "None of those facts were true, and any of the facts that were true were spun in such a maliciously wrong way. We've been working really hard on this movie, and we've had an excellent time working together." Lastly, the 3D conversion was abandoned to reallocate funds toward completing visual effects. That July, Fox and Trank tried to button down the rumor mill and went on the offensive. Trank promised the film would be an epic, massive, huge, multi-power slugfest with a lot of stakes. And the final trailer seemed to deliver on those ideas. Fox even got the ball rolling on a crossover between the Fantastic Four and their X-Men, going so far as to have a cast photo of all the series combined, including Channing Tatum as Gambit? Question mark? Cart before the horse, Fox. But they couldn't keep a good thing going, as the week before release turned into one PR disaster after another. The cast gave endless, awkward interviews.
You're an actor. Promote our film.
Revealing none of them had actually seen the final film, and one where Esquire called Miles Teller a dick 7 different times.
You're a dick.
Trank sent an email to the cast and crew saying their film was better than 99% of the comic book movies ever made. Then in a surefire sign that the studio had a dud on their hands, Fox held embargoes on publication reviews until the day before release. And once they came out, reviews were harsh to say the least. Awful, dull, cheesy, humorless, shameful. Slow and plodding with no real stakes and a complete lack of believable motivations or relationships. The only bright spots are the much-touted body horror sequences that are surprisingly effective. However, it's immediately forgotten, as the film quickly transitions into a generic, low-budget superhero flick that introduces one of the worst, nonsensical villains ever, 15 minutes before the end credits. The sum of all fears came to fruition. Then came the final nail in the coffin, Josh Trank's infamous tweet. A few hours after the reviews came crashing down, Trank tweeted, "A year ago, I had a fantastic version of this, and it would have received great reviews. You'll probably never see it." The director, who spent months downplaying the issues and denying the rumors, instantly threw his movie and 20th Century Fox under the bus. Fantastic Four bombed hard, making a paltry $25 million in its first weekend on a budget of $120 million. Analysts predict that Trank's outburst may have cost the film upwards of $10 million from its opening. The following week's gross dropped an astounding 68%. Is this comic book universe unfilmable or cursed? What happened? The final film shows all the signs of a movie self-correcting mid-edit. Miles Teller is obviously shoehorned into the back half of the film, green-screened into scenes he was clearly not present for. From scene to scene, Kate Mara's real hair is unmistakable from her reshoot wig. Jamie Bell was noticeably left on the edit room floor. Tim Blake Nelson, who signed on as Harvey Elder, aka the villain Mole Man, is only called Harvey once.
He's scared, Harvey.
And is actually listed as Dr. Allen in the credits. The action sequences, heavily marketed in the trailers, are entirely absent. Undoubtedly to appease fans, Victor Domyshev is ADR'd into Victor Von Doom with a single insert.
Wait, what is this?
Victor Von Doom is on here.
Toby Kebbell later revealed that not only was Doom played by someone else in the suit, but that Trank did cut a great film that you'll never see. Shortly after release, a series of exposés detailed more of the turmoil and unraveling, giving lots of insight into Trank's behavior. According to The Hollywood Reporter, Trank became a recluse after constant fights with the studio, struggling to save his original cut. So withdrawn, he built a black tent around his monitor to avoid everyone. He began instructing his actors when to blink and when to breathe, and it led to what many sources described as an unsalvageable film. Meanwhile, Fox was trying to avoid its consistent reputation of micromanaging filmmakers by not intervening. Entertainment Weekly's far more damning piece depicted Trank as cold, cruel, insulting, and abusive. An indecisive director who wouldn't commit to anything and would lose his temper when decisions were made for him. When the studio mandated that Kate Mara be cast as Sue Storm, Trank, in return, pushed to cast Miles Teller, but then literally almost fought him on set as the two had clashing personalities. Remember, Teller is a dick. And what may have been the catalyst for everything that transpired, Trank's budget was slashed by $30 million only days before production, forcing him to cut multiple action sequences, such as the Thing's airdrop. Fox entrusted Fantastic Four to an artist not ready for the big leagues, then proceeded to simultaneously hinder his efforts and let the chaos unfold. Whoever's fault it is, it's another example of a studio and a filmmaker in a bitter feud for a film's soul. Fantastic Four had a low bar to clear, and it somehow managed to limbo its way underneath and fall flat on its back. it may go down as one of the worst comic book movies ever made. Fox was quick to say that they were disappointed by the response, but they still value the characters and have plans for them in the future. Yet for all of Fox's efforts to maintain the rights to one of Marvel's most beloved properties, the return on investment has hardly seemed worth it. To the delight of fans everywhere, Disney bought 20th Century Fox's entire entertainment division in 2018, along with the rights to the Fantastic Four and X-Men. Perhaps Kevin Feige and the MCU can do right by Marvel's first family one day, but until then, we can still enjoy at least one Disney property about a super household.